So good afternoon. Thank you all very much for joining us this afternoon as part of GDC. So what we'd like to present today to all of you is what we're calling Project Skyline. Project Skyline is a project that we've been working on at Autodesk for a couple of years now. It's a very exciting new type of workflow for animation that connects classical keyframe animation, behavior authoring, and runtime all together. We'll talk a little bit more about it as we go through the show. And we also have a partner who's working with Skyline here, Alex Pechev from Ikinema, who will also talk a little bit about how he's working with Skyline and how Ikinema is leveraging it. So I'll just quickly go through some introductions. So myself, I'm Matt Mazerol. I work at Autodesk, but I'm actually a game developer who's hiding inside of Autodesk, building tools to help game developers make better games. I've been in the game industry for about, 16 years. And my last title was actually Assassin's Creed. The first Assassin's Creed, I was the lead engineer on that. And I've come to Autodesk because I really think there's a fantastic opportunity to build better tools for game developers across the board. I have with me Steven Rosell, who's an application engineer with us. And he is the maestro of Skyline. And he's going to take you through a tour of actually using Skyline to build some gameplay, which will be pretty cool. And Alex Pechev from Ikinema, who's a partner who's working with us, leveraging Skyline technology. And he's going to present Ikinema in the context of Skyline and some of the cool stuff that that happens with that. So maybe we can just dive right into things. We're just going to do a couple of slides. They're not going to be very long. I'd like to just first remind all of you to please turn off your phones. It's kind of like one of those movie things. You don't want to be that guy with the beeping cell phone. Also, we're going to reserve some time for a Q&A at the end of the session. So please, you know, prepare your questions as we go through. Please be sure to fill out your feedback forms at the end of the session. That's very valuable feedback for us. I actually look at those things, believe it or not. So, cool. All right, here we go. Well, we're going to start it off with something really fascinating, which is a whole pile of legal language. We do this to basically say what we're presenting to you today. This is not a standing product. This is not something, you know, you should go back and say, you know, we're going to make purchasing decisions based on what you saw today. This is really something, you know, we're presenting to you in the spirit of, you know, showing you what we're working on. So please, you know, do not affect your purchasing decisions with what you see today. So, moving on. So I want to talk a little bit about what motivated us to build something like Project Skyline. So several years ago, Autodesk formulated a kind of a philosophy about sort of where how game pipelines were constructed and where Autodesk and a lot of content creation tools stood in the pipeline. We kind of had this realization that there was what we called the tale of two pipelines. Really, there was a pipeline for artists and a pipeline for programmers. And I'm sure many of you, you know, if you're in production, you probably feel that today. You know, programmers are from Mars and artists are from Venus. Well, one of the big things that Autodesk wanted to do is to understand that other pipeline. We want to understand the pipeline that everyone else lived in, level designers, programmers, behavior programmers, level designers, game designers. So we decided to start building out you know, some more runtime. So as you can see over the last few years, you know, we've made some acquisitions. You know, we've acquired some middleware companies. I'm sure you guys have seen you know, all the Scaleform stuff, the GameWare branding. This is really a big inflection point for Autodesk, where all of this runtime stuff is really reaching a point of critical mass. But there's actually a much bigger story around that. And the bigger story is, how do you put all this stuff together into joining it all with content creation tools? And the sort of spearhead of that is Project Skyline. And Project Skyline is meant to attack this syndrome of what we call the classical game pipeline. So the classical game pipeline, I'm sure you guys have all seen this picture. So, you know, you've got your tool for your artists, and then, you know, they export stuff, and then there's another tool for your game designers, your level designers, and they're assembling a bunch of stuff, and then there's some more magic that happens, and everything ends up in all this code in the runtime that all these programmers have made. And then once it's all in the engine, it all kind of comes together, and this is the point where basically everyone tries to figure out, why is it not working? You know, there's that sort of great big thud at the end, and then you end up kind of looking like this guy here. So, you know, let's just have a quick show of hands. How many people have this, you know, this linear pipeline, or have felt it or experienced it at some point in their life? Okay. So this is very, you know, this is a very kind of a classically structured pipeline. It's okay because you can move data through this pipeline very quick. Programmers can intervene and put breakpoints and stuff like that. But the big problem is what happens next is when people have to go back to the beginning. So there's problems with this pipeline. We can just go down the list really quick. But the biggest problem here is there's no connection between the runtime data and the authoring data. By the time your tree in Maya has ended up in the game runtime as some vertex buffer with some address, all the connections have been lost, and nobody really knows where to point the finger of blame anymore. If we were still making games this way today, there wouldn't be this many great games. So, more modern pipelines have emerged. And I'm sure this probably resonates with you guys too. We actually call this the martini glass of deliciousness. So it looks like a martini glass, but it's actually just kind of a simple, four-square diagram of a modern pipeline. The basic idea is you get all your content into an asset database as quickly as possible, where everything can be identified, everything has an ID, everything can have a version number, and everything can have multiple representations. And what this allows is your game editor and your game runtime to have multiple representations of the same asset, and they can agree on the identity of that asset. And then things get really cool when those things start talking to each other directly. So when the level editor says, move tree 0x58b, and the game runtime knows exactly what that means and is able to move that tree right there in your game while it's running, you get some pretty cool iteration time. We call this kind of the wormhole of iteration. It's where iteration time becomes zero. There's no export, there's no file. It's what we call live link. So this is kind of like the ideal, but of course there's some issues with this, namely that the content creation tools are kind of cut out of the pipeline. Maybe just advance one more slide. Yes, the martini glass of deliciousness. They're very refreshing, and they make good pipelines. So the good thing about these pipelines, obviously, is you have this live link. One of the most important aspects is you get backflow of information. Your game engine is now talking to you, right? You're not just throwing stuff into your game engine and exporting it. Your game engine is actually sending telemetry back to your level editor, and your level editor is actually intimately connected to your game engine. This resolves the, authoring representation and runtime representation. You also get collaboration. Because you can identify everything and you can identify the relationships between things, it becomes really easy to break things into groups that different groups of people can work on. So you can go and find all the trees for level 5 and someone can work on those and not have to worry about, stomping all over the work of the guy working on the trees for level 3, for example. There's a few weaknesses. The biggest weakness is the poor artists. They're cut out of this loop, They're possibly in Photoshop or Maya or whatever, and they're just toiling away on their Maya file or their Photoshop texture, and they're not necessarily seeing the results in game directly like the folks in the level editor are. Also, if you're building this pipeline, you have to build it. It's expensive. You can buy a lot of commercial engines that actually do this. Some of them do a really great job. Unreal does a really fantastic job. CryEngine does a great job. Unity does a fantastic job. We start seeing these live authoring workflows in these modern game engines as being a cornerstone of what makes them really great. But if you're building this yourself, it can be pretty expensive. And fundamentally, you don't want to build it because it doesn't have anything to do with making a good game. You just want to make a good game. You don't want to make plumbing. So we say leave the plumbing to Autodesk. And this is why we're building Project Skyline. So, Project Skyline, it's a forward-looking technology for authoring animations, assembling them into gameplay with state machines, blend trees, game logic, and you can inspect and debug the results by giving artists, TDs, and programmers a window into your game runtime, and all of this happens live in your engine while it's running. So, we can kind of show you what that martini glass looks like with Skyline in the picture, and the idea is that by building all this plumbing, we're using animation is one example, but you can imagine other stuff being plugged in. What's really neat is we are already working with, companies like Akinema is really great because they're actually already leveraging a lot of the plumbing that we're trying to build between the authoring tool and the runtime. It allows, really, really awesome runtimes like Akinema to be able to plug in and leverage all this stuff and really show off their strengths while leaving all of the authoring and all of the UI and all of the communication stuff to us. So, Project Skyline has two components, an animation runtime and an authoring component, and Steven will be walking through a demo of what that actually looks like. So before I get into it too much, how many of you have seen Skyline before? I think we showed it at GDC, and there's one. Okay, great. So maybe a couple of you have seen this before. So I'll just cover really briefly, you know, what's new and exciting, and actually these are some of the most exciting features anyway. Really improved UI, fantastic workflow. Blend-aware state machines. You know, state machines are great, but you don't want to just flip from one animation to another. You want to have nice blends between states. Bone masks. You know, being able to run multiple state machines on a character that are composited together. We pre-integrate human IK. Obviously, you know, Alex is going to talk about Ikinema as well. They're both fantastic solutions that can extend Skyline to really have fantastic IK and procedural animation, which is really important. Collaboration versioning, we've worked really hard on that, so multiple people can work on Skyline at once. We have an AI perception blackboard, so your AI has a way of communicating with the game, with the Skyline by posting the information it needs, so Skyline can go and retrieve and actually use that in a blend graph. And we also have really cool debugging facilities like game camera synchronization, so you can use all the Maya camera tools to control your game runtime's camera and vice versa, so we'll show a little bit of that too. So without further ado, we'll jump right into it and have Steven show off you know, all the awesomeness.
All right, so I'm going to kind of dive in here and kind of show you what Skyline is all about. First, before I talk about Skyline, I'm just going to do a quick introduction of the game that we're using to basically show some of the animation that we're working with. So here I have a character that basically is essentially the animation is authored with Skyline, but we're actually using this game as kind of a test bed for a variety of our gameware tools. So, for instance, we're using it for Beast, and we're using it for Scaleform, for UI creation or heads-up displays and whatnot. But it's also a kind of a testbed for Skyline. So, obviously, I have different animations in here. I can trigger jumps, I can trigger a crouch motion, and then I can go into different animations from there, walking and jogging and so on. I have also a fire animation in here where I can fire my weapon. So let's move back and we'll talk about how this actually kind of ties in with Skyline. So Skyline actually is built on top of Maya. So what it actually does is it kind of bridges the gap between Maya and the running game. So what you'll see here is actually my Skyline project. So for those of you that are familiar with Maya, this is kind of like the Outliner. It's not the Outliner, but it's kind of similar. It's basically kind of access to all of the assets that you would be working with in the game. And each one of these basically is associated with Maya files. So we've got a few different things in here. We have our skeleton definition, which basically is a file that kind of defines the skeletal structure of our character. And then we've got clip groups, which contain animation that are then basically associated with that character. And then we have things like behaviors, which are essentially the state machines and node graphs or animation trees that are determining the gameplay. So. What you see over here on the left-hand side is Maya. So this is just regular Maya. If I open up this other interface, this is actually the game watch. This is essentially Skyline. So what you'll see is it's actually a separate window that just kind of resides on top of Maya. So this is the bridge between Maya and the game. So right now I'm just seeing kind of an empty game watch, but with the game running, I can actually connect to the game. And essentially discover the assets in the game and kind of agree upon what those assets are and then load those assets into Maya through my project over here. So we're going to give that a second to connect. I want to point out one thing is that this game could be running in a number of different places. So this could be running locally, or this could be running on a remote machine, or this could be running on a PS3 or an Xbox 360. It just happens to be local on this machine. And I also should point out that the game itself is built on top of Unreal. So we'll talk a little bit more about Unreal integration later, but just wanted to point that out kind of in advance. So what you'll notice right away is that as soon as I start navigating, or rather moving my character around within my scene, you'll notice that that's now showing up in Maya in a regular Maya viewport. So what I have here is a live Maya viewport with meshes, skeletons, and obviously shading and texturing on those meshes. So I'm going to go in here and actually just simplify this. You can see the skeleton's actually in here. I can actually go in and select it just like a regular skeleton. For display purposes, I'm actually just going to go in and hide that and just show the mesh. And now what you'll see is that as I begin to work with my character in the game, it is actually updating in the Maya viewport, at least it's supposed to be. for some reason, it's actually getting a little bit of a lag. I don't know if it's because of the projector or what, but there we go. Now you can actually start to see it. So you can see I've got a live connection now between the game and Maya. I can also switch over to a game control, a game camera control or a Maya camera control. So before I was actually running around the game and that was driving the Maya camera. I can also switch to a Maya camera and then I can actually go in and I can use my regular, you know, selection and framing tools and then use my camera controls in Maya to have that update the game. So now you can see I can actually kind of focus in on a specific area of my character. So if I wanted to look at how like the feet are blending between certain clips, I can use the Maya camera to get in there and get a real close look at it. Now another thing you'll notice, I'm going to pull back here, is the time trace. The time trace is actually a graphical view of what I have actually running in the game. So let me switch back over to my game camera, and we'll pull into the time trace and start running around. And what you'll see that is, as I run around, you'll notice that different clips actually will show up in the time trace. So this is a graphical representation of what I'm doing. So when I hit the A button and I trigger a jump, then I'm actually going to see the jump clip show up. I think I'm up against the wall there. Yeah, I am. I'm actually going to see the jump clip show up in the time trace. Now, the one thing that's really cool about this is that I can actually go in here and I can pause this. So before I had a live running game, I was actually driving it myself. I'm going to pause it, and now I can actually go into the time trace, and I can scrub through the time trace, and I can see the history of my gameplay. So I can go in here, and I can actually take a look at what that looks like when I jump. I can stop it right there, then I can go in and use Maya's camera to actually frame in on the character and get a really close look at a very specific point in time and actually freeze that. Now I can also go in here and I can dive in and I could actually open the clip from here. I'm not going to do that right now just for time's sake, but I wanted to point out a couple of things. Is from the top down, what I'm actually seeing is a couple of things. I'm seeing the state machine at the top, and then I'm seeing a couple of state machines blended on top of that base state machine, and then I'm seeing things like markers. For instance, these little tick marks here are actually markers that tell me where my character's feet are hitting the ground. Then I can use that in the game to actually get better blending, say, for instance, between a jog and a run so that the feet blend correctly. Or I could use it to trigger something completely unrelated, like an audio clip or like a sound effect or like a particle effect or something like that. So that data could be used in the game for different purposes. Now, and then all the other stuff here are the clips themselves. So before I go into too much detail there, let's pull back. And actually, I'm going to unpause the game, make it live again. And we're going to go into the node editor. And so this is where all the action happens, basically. This is where I build what we're actually seeing running in the game. So let's frame in here to the node editor. I've got to make it nice and big so you guys can see what's going on. But basically, what we have here is kind of the highest level view of my node structure. This is actually the state machines. And the state machines basically are doing different things. So I have a body state machine, which is kind of my base animation. So that's actually controlling the general locomotion of my character. Is he running? Is he jogging? Is he jumping? Whatever. And then I also have a... I keep getting stuck behind that box. I also have a weapon state machine on top of that. So when I fire my weapon, you'll notice that it overrides the upper body animation. So if I point out here and actually do that, you can see a little bit better. So there you'll see the upper body animation is being affected by the weapon state machine. And then blended on top of that, I have a third state machine, the reaction state machine, which is actually an overlay on top of all this so that if I get hit by enemy fire, as I'm running and as I'm firing, it'll also blend a little bit of reaction on top of all that. So then if I dive in at a slightly lower level, if I go into a specific state machine, you can actually see what's going on here. This state machine is my body state machine where I'm doing my basic locomotion, and you'll see that it defaults to an idle. But from an idle, I could then go, for instance, to a jog. From a jog, I could then go to a run, and from a run, I can go to a fall, which would lead me to a land, which would ultimately lead me back to my idle. So these are all the various states with connections between them, and then there are conditions on those connections that determine exactly how the transition happens, when it happens and how it happens, and based on what event it might happen. So I can go even further. If I dive in, for instance, to a specific state, I can actually start to take a look at the node structure of that state, and this is actually the animation tree. So, for instance, for a jog, I have a jog forward, I have a jog right, and I have a jog left, which ultimately get blended kind of downstream, and then a few other nodes are applied here. I'm not going to go into all the details of the node structure here, but ultimately that goes to the output of that particular state. So let's pull back here a little bit, and we'll talk about actually creating some of this stuff from scratch. So before I do that, I'm going to let Matthew just talk kind of generally and conceptually about what we're showing here before I get into the details. So.
Yeah.
So for those of you who've kind of seen this sort of notator workflow for the first time, this is something that, you know, is present in a few Autodesk tools like Softimage, Ice has a notator, Maya has a notator. What's very special about this one is that there's a technology underneath this which we call Amino. Amino is actually a technology that compiles these graphs down into a runtime-ready format. So all these really complex graphs that Steven is showing can be simplified into compounds and compounds and compounds, but underneath it all is this really, really intricate web of all these commands that bind to your game engine that do things like animation or different effects. For example, in the case of Ikinema, we bind nodes to Ikinema's runtime, and you know, just by creating wrappers, you can call into those runtime systems. And Amino, the Amino compiler, actually compiles all this down to a highly parallelized structure where we can actually run multiple branches of the state machine at the same time. So if we know we're going to composite an upper body state machine and a shoot state machine, we can actually composite those on two separate threads. And when they actually blend together, that's where we actually can sort of merge those two threads together. So there's a lot of research that we've put in terms of performance with this visual computing system. And we're pretty excited about the possibilities that this gives in order to decouple programmers from technical artists so that programmers can concentrate on exposing functionality and artists and technical artists can concentrate on how to assemble it, and they don't have to worry about, you know, intricate weaving it into the way the game will actually do its threading. So I'll let Steven go in, and as he's doing edits, you'll see everything propagates instantly to the game runtime. So.
Okay, so let's do something from scratch here. So basically, I'm trying to get myself into a position where I've got some room to work with. I don't want to fall off the ledge accidentally, which I've done before. So right now, you can see that I have my full state machine, or more my various state machines affecting my character. But let's say I want to start from scratch. So the first thing I would do is to create a state, a state machine. So I'm going to go in here and create an empty state machine, and we're just going to name this something like simple state machine. There we go. I'm going to dive into this. So every state machine has to have at least one state, generally a lot more than that, but at least one state. So I'm going to add a state, and this is going to be my basic idle state. So this is where I'm starting, basically. So I'm going to go in and just quickly rename this idle state, just so I know what it is. And then the state itself has to have something in it. So the most basic thing that I could have in here would be just an empty clip. And an empty clip is essentially the skeleton definition, so that it basically essentially puts it into a T-pose, which would have been defined on the Maya side. So I'm just putting this on here just so you can see what's happening. So the empty clip is going to feed into the output of that state. So obviously, I would generally have a lot more stuff going on in here, a lot of blending and various math nodes associated with it. But for now, we're going to keep it simple. And now I'm going to go up to the highest level, and I'm going to take my simple state machine, and I'm going to feed that into my game. So now what it's going to do is it's going to recompile. So it's a little hard to see, but there's a little visual indicator letting me know it's recompiling. And then once that updates, I'll actually see the result of that new state on my character. So there it is. Now, back in the game, you'll notice that my character is suddenly in this T-pose. So now I've completely lost control. I can't actually move my character. I can still trigger the camera and things like that. The camera is being affected, but the character is not. So let's pull back, and I'm actually going to delete all this more kind of complex stuff, and we'll start from scratch at kind of a lower level here. So now I have my state machine with a single state, and then within that state I've got a raw empty clip that doesn't do anything. So the next step would be to actually put some animation in here. So I'm going to go back to Maya, and this is where we're going to actually bring in some animation. So as I said in the beginning, there's something called a skeleton definition, which is basically defining the skeletal structure of your character. And then associated with that, we have various clips, which actually essentially contain the animation. So we've got different categories here. For instance, under locomotion, I've got a bunch of different idle and jog and run clips. So if I were doing this from scratch, I could either open the original skeleton file and animate that directly, or I could build a rig on top of it, or I can go in and use something like HIK. But for now, I'm actually going to use something that's already been created for time's sake. So I'm going to create a new clip within the locomotion group, and we're going to call this my idle new. And instead of starting from scratch, I'm going to actually use a Maya file that has been animated. So we'll go in here, and I'll bring in my idle alternate file. So what that's going to do is that's actually going to load the Maya file that contains this animation. And then another thing that I would have had to have done in advance of this is basically create the clip and apply some basic clip information. For instance, where does the animation start? Where does the animation end? We also have something called bone masks, which allow you to filter out different body parts, for instance. We're not going to do that right now. I'll actually show an example later. And disregard the fact that he's completely discombobulated. That's actually because the solvers in the rig haven't kicked in yet. But once they do, he'll go back into his normal state. So there we go. So now if I were to go back and play this animation, you'll see that I just basically get a very, very simple idle here. Getting a little bit of lag, so we'll give that a second to update. But it hasn't actually been sent to the game. So I've created a clip. It's now accessible to the game, but it's not actually running in the game. All right.
Need more power.
I don't know if you have anything to say while this is actually loading.
Yeah, sure. I mean, we can talk a little bit about all that clip management is. Yeah, so we've got all this nice clip library. This is all stuff if you're into games, you're into animation. We organize things into clip groups. You can have variation. So, you know, if you have different types of, let's say, damage levels or tall characters, short characters, you can apply the same state machine to characters that have different animation banks as long as their animation banks match up in name. So we've organized everything in a way that's very obvious to game developers.
Okay, so we're good to go here. So what I've done is I've brought in my file. The clip was already set up, so I've basically, again, defined kind of the endpoints and outpoints of the clip. And now that's available to Skyline. So if you'll look over here in the project, now I've got a new clip that is the idle new. So now I want to basically go back to Skyline. I'm actually going to pause the animation here, or go back to the game watch, I should say. And I'm going to bring that in. So I'm going to bring in my idle new, and I'm going to just drop that in as my clip. And then I'm going to feed that into the output over here. And you'll see that that immediately updates in the game. So now my idle is a very simple kind of crouching idle, and that's about it. I don't really have anything else. So I still can't trigger any other animation. So let's make this a little bit more complex and add another state and then transition into that state. So I'll go in here and I'll just add a state, and we'll just call this my jump state. So again, if I needed to, I could go back and create animation from scratch. I've actually already created this in advance, so I'm going to bring in a clip that has already been created that basically will do an idle, a jump from the idle, and then it'll basically draw the weapon just so we can show some of the blending. So I'll feed that into the output of that state, and I'll go back up a level above that. And now, in order to actually see that, one thing I can do is I can make that my initial state. So right now, the idle state's the initial state, but if I come in here and set the jump state to the initial state, that will immediately feed the jump clip to my character. Now you'll see my character is jumping in a loop in the game. So I haven't actually done any transitioning. All I've done is I've just enabled that clip, basically. So what I really want to do is actually transition from the idle to the jump. So I'll set the idle back to my initial state. Again, you'll see it update in the game. And now I'll just create a quick connection. Now watch what happens. As soon as I do that, it immediately transitions from the idle to the jump. So it's just immediately gone into that next state because I haven't actually told it how and when, and I haven't defined basically the condition, essentially. So instead of happening immediately, I want this to happen based on either an event in the game or an event from the gamepad. For instance, right now, I want to basically trigger the jump by hitting a button on my gamepad. So what I'm going to do is just double-click on the condition itself, and I'm going to, or rather the connection itself, and I'm going to create an AI event, or rather define an AI event. So this AI event would have been created for me by a programmer or a technical artist. So I have an event that is called do jump, and that is associated with the A button on my gamepad. So now, when I hit enter, it automatically updates, so it's gone back to its initial state, which is the idle, and as soon as I hit the A button, it'll transition, or rather it'll actually just switch into that new state, which is the jump state. So what you'll notice is that when I do that, if I reset that initial state, it'll actually just immediately pop. So it just goes right into that state, but I haven't actually defined any kind of blending. I haven't actually determined when it's going to happen. It just automatically goes. So now I want to take it a step further, and I want to actually add some blending. So blending can be done in a number of ways. So one thing I can do is I can do a simple crossfade transition. And a crossfade is basically just going to do a straight blend, essentially. I could also do something called a sync crossfade, which would allow me, like I mentioned earlier, to do a crossfade based, for instance, on footsteps. So if I'm jogging to running, I can actually blend based on where those footsteps are so that I don't get some weird like stutter step in the blend. But what I'm going to actually do here is just set my, whoops. We'll talk about that in a second. So I'm going to set my crossfade transition, and then I want to go in and actually determine how much time that I want that transition to take. So I'm actually going to set it to about 0.2 seconds. So now what you'll see is that initially he's idling. As soon as I hit the A button, now he transitions into the jump, and you'll see the blend actually happens. I'll show that one more time just so you can actually see it. So he's in his idle state. I hit the A button, and he transitions into the jump. So I would obviously connect back to the idle state. For time's sake, I'm actually going to move on. But one, before I leave this part of the demonstration, one thing I want to point out is, and it's at kind of the most powerful concept about all this, is that I can actually go back to that Maya file and I can make changes. So if I go back to the Maya file, which is still loaded, or I could reload it if it wasn't there, I can actually come in here now and I can start to make some changes. Let me quickly switch back to my initial state so you can actually see this. So I'm going to set my initial state back to the idle. And one thing you'll notice is that when I do my blend, notice where his hips are. His hips are kind of low down to the ground. He's almost crouching. And then when I transition, he kind of goes up into this like higher point of where his center of gravity is higher. So I actually want to have that blend happen a little more seamlessly using a higher point of the hips for the initial state. So let's reset the initial state. I'll go back to Maya, and I'll just make a couple of changes. So the rig here is actually completely independent of Skyline. So the rig is actually just a custom rig. As I mentioned in the beginning, this could be an HIK rig, or this could be just straight skeleton animation. It could be mocap animation, for instance. But what I actually have here is a rig on top of the skeleton. So I can use any of Maya's animation tools to animate this, and it ultimately gets baked down to the joint level. So I'm going to take the hip controller, and I'm going to grab the hand controllers. Now, I could actually go in and edit the original keyframes. I'm not going to take the time to do that. I'm going to do something a little simpler, which is just add an animation layer to create an offset. So I'll go in here and create an animation layer. And now what I want to do is basically just offset this guy so that he's actually a little bit higher off the ground. So I'll just kind of pull him up there. Something like that. Now, you can technically set this up to be an auto bake. You'll see this little bar on the lower right. Actually, you guys don't see that, do you? I just realized that you're not seeing part of my UI. So you see the little bar there on the lower left. That's actually a visual indicator to let me know when it's actually processing or when it's actually baking. So I could set this to auto bake so that anytime I set a keyframe, it would automatically bake. I'm not going to do that right now. I'm just going to do a manual bake. And what that will do is it will take all that animation from the rig, it will put it down to the joints, put it onto the joints, and then it will send that to the game. So it's processing, and pretty quickly, if you watch the game, it'll update with the new hip location. It's supposed to, anyway. I'm getting some weird lag here, unfortunately. That's the beauty of a live demo. You never know. Oh. I didn't set the keyframe. No wonder. Okay, so what I did is I actually processed the same exact animation, which doesn't do me any good. So I need to go in and offset that, set the keyframe, so I've actually created a keyframe, and then I'll go in and I'll reprocess that.
So one thing to notice here, which is really powerful, we've just done, and it you know, might just be coming through, is we've actually gone and changed, we've realized after the construction of the state machine that we actually needed to restylize this animation to make it suit the kind of the mechanics of the gameplay. You know, when you're doing mechanics and aesthetics in game production, often those things don't quite connect. What we've just done here is we've seamlessly transitioned from mechanics to aesthetics, and we've been able to go back to Maya to edit the aesthetics so that they match the desired mechanics of the gameplay. That's a really powerful concept, and if you really take that to its extreme, it really opens up a lot of doors.
So I'm actually going to do a quick restart here because it's a noticeable lag.
Sure. Is it going to be faster if you plug in?
What's that?
It'd be faster if you plug in your computer.
What do you mean?
The CPU.
Oh, is that? That's why. Oh, my God. No wonder.
More power.
Why didn't you tell me before?
I don't know.
Okay. I knew something wasn't right. Okay, so so we're going to go in and do a couple other things here. I'm going to do a quick time check. It looks like we've got about 10
minutes.
We'll
take an extra 5 minutes. We'll cut into the... Yeah.
Okay. So what I want to do is actually go in and dive in a little bit deeper to one of the animation trees and talk about kind of some lower level type editing. So we're going to bring our project back up here. Just take a few seconds to load. One thing to point out that I actually didn't point out in the beginning, so this is a happy accident, is that we have revision control, so we've integrated Perforce. I'm not actually using it right now, but it is integrated and we could be using it. So let's go back to the game watch and I'll just connect to the new game.
I'll just talk about the collaboration aspect while Steven's setting up. So we actually are, vetting Skyline at some very early stages and with people in production. So what's really cool is, you know, large groups of people work on animation. That's just the reality. And we've set Skyline up so that, you know, there's revision control built in, there's a notion of versioning, and everything that Skyline works on is versioned, is collaborative. You can put your own back end, whether it's Perforce or SVN or whatever it is. So, you know, this idea that this is a collaboration-ready tool for game production is actually something that's pretty exciting, and it's something that really extends, you know, Maya's, you know, and Autodesk's workflow well beyond, you know, the sort of traditional area of, you know, one artist, one tool. So this is kind of an exciting area for us to be getting into.
Okay, so I'm kind of just getting back to where I was. So what I've done is actually is I've skipped ahead just a little bit here from where I was. I actually have reloaded the entire state machine, but I've only hooked up the body state machine. So you'll notice I can run around and I can trigger my runs and jumps and all that. But if I fire my weapon, notice that the weapon state machine is not working right now because I haven't actually hooked it up. So before I actually get into that, I want to show just really quickly some of kind of the lower level stuff that we can do here. So as I mentioned before, if I dive into any one of these states, each state is made up of an animation tree basically, but I can also create node structures for the conditions themselves. So for instance, right now I have a fall to land. If I dive in and I take a look at that, the fall to land condition basically for that transition is actually a node structure. And if I dive in a little lower, you can actually see that I've got a kind of a hierarchical structure here. So I've got compounds that have been created. I'll show you how we created the compound that basically contain other node structures. And what's actually happening here is that when I jump, he goes from a jump to a fall to a land. And right now, it's just basically doing an idle to a jump to a land, but he may jump off of a two-story building, or he may jump off of a box or something. So the distance that he falls is going to be different depending on where he jumps from. So what's actually happening here, instead of doing a straight transition, is it's actually checking his velocity based on his location, and it's actually doing a raycast to figure out how far away he is from the ground. And based on that distance, we're going to trigger the transition at a certain distance from the ground, which could be variable. It could be different depending on where I am in the game. So one thing I want to show here is that I can actually take something like this, this complex node structure, and I can make a compound out of it. So if I take this, and again, this is nested too, so I have compounds within compounds. I'm going to create a compound, and we're just going to rename this just something simple. I'll just call it my compound. And what I'm going to do also is I'm going to expose some values from within this node structure. So what you'll notice here is I have a less than here that is hardwired. So this is actually related to the distance from the ground. So basically, it's actually more time. So it's basically 0.15 seconds from the ground. So it figures out how far away is and what time is related to that, essentially. So what I can do is I can take that value and I can expose that as a port, essentially. And I can call this something specific. So let's just say time. So now what I can actually do is save all that out as a reusable compound. So you'll see here I've exposed time. Now my artists or an artist can go in and use that and just connect right into it. So I'm actually going to export this compound. We'll just keep the same name. What that will do is that will put that in my node library. So you'll see the node library over here. This is actually made up of a combination of things. So I could have something as simple as an if condition, which basically just does a simple comparison and then spits out a result. That's kind of a low-level node, but I also have compounds within this. So I can actually just get rid of the compound I had before, and I can bring that back at any point. So I have something called my compound. I can drag that in and reuse it as many times as I need to. And another thing I can do is I can actually define this as a condition. So if I just say I want to tag this as a condition, what that means is I can reuse it as a condition on a connection between states. So I've basically exposed it as a condition. So if I go back up to the higher level state machine, what you'll see here is I can actually break this connection, and now I have no way of getting from fall to land. So when I do that, it's obviously going to recompile. I'll run around here a little bit, and now when I come back in to jump, he's going to jump, and then he's going to fall, but he's not going to land because he doesn't know how to land. So this is where I would go in and rebuild the connection. Again, if I just make the connection, then it's going to automatically just jump immediately, or rather go immediately from fall to land. So I want to actually have that transition happen based on that condition that complex condition that I created earlier. Because I defined it as a condition, I can now just load that directly. So I can load my compound now as a condition that contains that complex node structure, and I have a value there. You see the time value exposed, so I can say now I want that to happen 0.2 seconds from when he hits the ground. So it goes in and it does that kind of calculation, figures out how far away he is from the ground, and then it does the transition based on that distance or time. So So the next thing I want to talk about is actually how to kind of combine these state machines together and actually use multiple state machines. Do you want to say anything about that? Or?
Sure. So what's really neat in Skyline is the way we sort of have a unified view of, you know, what a blend tree versus what a blend tree versus state machine is. You can move seamlessly from blend trees to states and states to blend trees. And the idea really is that you'll have many, many state machines running at the same time on your character. You'll have something maybe managing the face and then something else managing the upper body or the lower body or multiple weapons. And the really cool thing that Skyline allows you to do is to sculpt the complexity of each one of those state machines independently and make them reusable. So you can make a really basic system to prototype stuff out, and then you can go in and make it more and more and more complex. You can reuse these things, and you can layer and composite them in a very natural way. And you don't really need to go in and write a whole bunch of code and stop your game. And, you know, you can do this all very organically, and it's a very organic workflow. So Steven's going to actually show how we combine, you know, the upper body and the weapon state machine to basically composite them together.
Okay, so what I've done is I brought in the weapon state machine. Again, if I fire my weapon, just to reiterate, you'll notice that it does indeed fire, but my body doesn't react, or my upper body doesn't react. So what I'm going to do is actually bring in a simple layer blend, which is actually a compound in itself. So if I bring in my layer blend, this is just like blending like 2D, when you're compositing or whatever. It's similar to my animation layers. But basically, this is a complex node structure in itself, which is also made up of other complex node structures. But for me, as an artist, all I care about is that I have two animation inputs and a blend value, or rather, a blend method. So what I'm going to do is actually expose those ports, and I'm going to feed the body state machine into the base layer, and I'm going to feed the weapon state machine into the layer above that. And then I'm going to take that output of the layer blend, and I'm going to feed that into my game, essentially. So one thing to point out is that this is actually an override. So I have a couple of options here. I can do an additive or a subtractive as well. But for an additive example, I would basically kind of composite animation on top of an existing animation. For an override, I'm actually going to be overriding the animation with something completely new. So when I fire, for instance, now the body is going to override the animation, whether it's a run or whether it's a crouch or whether it's a walk or whatever. So I think for time's sake, I'm going to have to skip the demo of the bone masking.
Yeah,
I can talk about it. So one thing I can point out here is that you'll notice that when he shoots forward, only the upper body is affected. When he shoots to the left, however, the upper body and the lower body are affected. Now, I'll just kind of loosely talk about what's happening here. So we have this concept of bone masking where you can actually go in and filter essentially what body parts are getting affected for instance, an override. And that can be done with a node as well, or it could be predefined on the clip itself. So what's happened here is I have not defined the bone mask, so it's actually overriding the entire clip as opposed to only overriding the upper body. And that's just a simple switch. I just go back to the original Maya file, and on the clip, I just say, I only want this to affect the upper body, and that immediately updates in the game with that appropriate mask. But again, for time's sake, I'm not actually going to show that because I don't want to eat too much into the rest of the time. The last thing I really want to show here is the HIK integration. So the HIK integration, HIK is not dependent on Skyline, nor is Skyline dependent on HIK, but we do have full HIK integration here, which allows us to do things like corrective animation. So for instance, if I go into first person point of view here, you can really see this. As I fire my weapon, notice how the FK animation kicks in, his arm goes up, but it doesn't actually point at the target. So I'm not actually aiming correctly at the target. You can also see it if I go into this kind of mode here where I'm shooting down at the ground. Notice how the target is a little bit offset. So the FK is working, but it's not actually working the way I need it to. So what I can do is I can grab something called an HIK correction, which is actually a compound itself. Pardon me. Right there. And if this has the appropriate inputs and outputs, I can actually drag it right onto an existing connection, and it'll just splice it right into that. So now what it's going to do is it's going to take the output of my weapon state machine, which is comped over my body state machine, and then it's going to do a correction based on a target in the game. So if I go into my quickfire here, you can see it's actually doing a get data, which is essentially getting the target location from the game, and then the HIK is then correcting the FK animation. So if we go back to the game, you can actually see that now when I aim up, his arm is actually going to point up. So it's not actually just using FK at this point. So same thing if I go kind of down here and point. Now he's actually pointing directly at the target. So It's looking like, we don't want to eat too much into this time, so maybe we should, do you want to talk about, show the Unreal movie real quick? Or?
No, I think we'll switch to showing off a keynote. Actually, it's a really good segue, actually, talking a little bit about the procedural aspects that Skyline opens up. And one of the people we've been working with in order to bring more extensibility into Skyline, because we really want Skyline to be an extensible system. Game developers have a whole bunch of systems of their own that they want exposed to Skyline. There's excellent third-party runtimes such as Akinema that also bring excellent functionality. So I'll let Alex talk a little bit about Akinema and what it brings to the table and how it leverages Skyline. Akinema is a full-body IK system that's just really, really flexible. HIK is a good starting point, but Akinema really takes things to the next level, and we're really happy to have him working with Skyline because it really shows off the mutual strengths of both systems. So I'll turn it over to Alex, and he can give you guys the rundown. So feel free to take the time you need.
Thanks a lot, Matt. Good afternoon to everyone. Thanks, Matt. My name is Alexander Peshev, and I'm with Akinema. And recently we started working with Autodesk and specifically the Skyline guys on bringing our technology into this project. I will start with a couple of opening statements. We started sort of 3-4 years ago, but from the very beginning we recognized that animation sort of has seen less attention in recent years in comparison to other technologies, for example, physics, rendering, game engines in general. And some of the approaches that are used currently in games haven't changed really for decades, skeletal-based animation or AFK animation. Larger studios have spent a considerable effort in developing their own know-how solutions, but these solutions, unfortunately, are not portable to other projects in most cases, and when you start one project, you start from scratch pretty much. Now, in terms of what we do, we try to improve the animation in games. And how do we do that? By customizing the asset in runtime. Really what you end up is with developing less animation assets and generating more assets in runtime procedurally. In addition to saving sort of on memory or other resources, it also allows you to sort of unlock your animation asset at any point of the design. And traditionally, if you think about this classical pipeline that Matt presented, this feedback from the runtime side going back to your animation assets is really time-consuming and difficult. But bringing tools like what Project Skyline is offering and other integration tools like ours allows you to actually at a very later stage to fine-tune and adjust your look and feel of what you want to get as an artist and as a designer. Our technology has been ported from iOS, Android to high-end game consoles. But when we started, we actually realized that we have a problem. And the problem is that we are not an animation engine as such. We are a component of an animation engine. We never had the ambition to build an animation engine. We wanted to specialize in what we do best, and this is our full body solver. And it was very difficult to find a unique way to actually provide this to our clients. So every integration of Akinema is sort of unique, and it varies from one project to another. And when we realized that Autodesk is starting on this project, and when this project was introduced to us, for us it was very exciting to actually find a way to provide our technology in a standard, if you wish, way, or in a unified framework. So we have now technology as a plugin to Autodesk Maya. In the very same fashion, we see how we now plug our runtime technology as a part of Project Skyline. So there are two components. One component is our Maya plugin, which takes a part of the offline authoring stuff. And then we have a runtime component, which is now embedded and wrapped in the game. But what is interesting is that now you can start building assets or building animation logic very quickly by just pulling a couple of wires in your behavioral graph. Now customization of animation in runtime becomes a routine task. It's just a matter, as you saw just a second ago in the demo, it's just a matter of coming back with those behaviors and tuning those behaviors in the way you want to see them. Complex behaviors, it requires really quickly adjusting those graphs and coming up with exactly the idea. But again, most importantly, you can do this at any time of your design, and you can be the artist who is involved actually in this process. You don't have to be the programmer who actually sits back at the back of the computer and writes C++ code. So the artist, we believe with this approach, is in a full control now in the actual aspect of the design of the game. So if we take an example, iKinema is a node in the system. So you can see this node here. Usually it comes at a sort of final stage in the design where you have the blended pose pre-blended. And once you get this node produces the pose that you essentially render. So this is a basic look at behavior, which I've included, but this is the final result that you get. This is an integration done in runtime based on our node in Project Skyline. It's running in a different engine, Fire Engine from Sony, but essentially it's the same idea. You have two characters. It's an idle animation, but on top of that, you have some look at behavior that you just programmed with a couple of nodes linked together. I will show you some other examples of what you can do, and we are slowly porting some of our tools or API, if you wish, to Project Skyline. You have here a retargeting with stretch in this particular example on the legs. Then you have physics driving some part of the bodies, and then also some objects which are attached to the body. But on top of that, you have a look at behavior which is sort of linked to a specific object, and you follow this object. Some other examples where you have a point at examples, you have a full body response. This is the original keyframed animation that you start with. This is retargeted to that character. In runtime, you adjust look at behavior and pointing behavior toward this object. Something interesting that we have as a technology is adding forces to any bones. So you can actually customize in terms of posing the response on the body by specifying a force that act on any part of the skeleton. So there is a force which is linked to this green ball which hits the character at a particular part of the body, and this corresponds to modifying the pose procedurally. And you can tune direction and so on. Again, this is part of this graph, so you can add this and link even with physics environments to determine direction of force and magnitude of the force. Some other examples with linking with physics, so you have a rigid body which is sort of hanging on this side. This motion is retargeted to that character. On top of that, you specify some additional constraints, bending the knees, look at behavior, moving the hips, and so on. Again, quite quickly, this can be designed using behavior and in the graph node. And you can do this on quite many characters. It's not time consuming, so CPU quite effective. So in this example, you drive for around 100, actually over 100 characters in real time. With this, I would like to conclude and thank you for giving me the opportunity to sort of comment on Project Skyline. And again, the message that I'm trying to emphasize is that for third-party developers that specialize in one specific tool, it's quite interesting the opportunity to become a part of unified framework and provide these tools to everyone to actually start using.
Thank you, and thank you, Alex. Those demos are really cool, and I think, you know, what really strikes me is just how something as powerful as iKinema can become even more powerful when you have that ability to fine-tune and get those kind of really complex and natural behaviors in real time. it just really brings out that expressivity. And I think those demos just looked really natural. And you know, seeing something procedural that generates something really natural with a node-based type of interface with instant feedback is pretty much, you know, for me on my projects, it would have been a dream come true. So congratulations. I think that was a great demo. So Stephen, maybe we can switch back to the PowerPoint. I'll just conclude with my corny ending. no worries. There we go. That was the demo. That was before we put. There we are. So obviously, some of you would like to know next steps. We'll jump into the questions in a second. So we're presently Project Skyline is just that. It's a project. We are working, you know, with some customers on a very early basis. But you know, we're at very early stages. I'd like to invite you. You know, if you're in production or you're interested by this kind of thing. If you're looking at retooling your pipeline for next gen, you know, we're looking for partners. You know, I'm sure we'd be interested, and Alex would be interested as well. So please, you know, come talk to us. Anytime you want, we'll give you a business card and have a chat. And just go to the last slide. You know, talk about Ikinema. You know, best of both worlds. Very happy to be working with third parties. And finally, to conclude, Sven says thank you. And I say thank you, and we'd be glad to take your questions. So I know we're kind of short on time, but we'll do what we can. All right, thank you.